Library Barnes & Noble Book Fair takes place from 11 a.m. to 4 p.m. at Barnes & Noble Booksellers at 230 Main Street, City Center in White Plains. It's a free event with book signings, concerts, children's stories, face painting, arts and crafts, and talks. And the event is a fundraiser for the Martin Luther King Jr. Freedom Library. On Saturday, January 20th, you can find out about Making Media That Matters at MNN Manhattan Neighborhood Network's free orientations at the MNN 59th Street Studios in Midtown or the El Barrio Firehouse Community Media Center in East Harlem. MNN is a public access television network and media education center offering hyper-local programming and low-cost media production courses to Manhattan residents. You can register for one of the free orientations by going to mnn.org. This has been your WBAI Community Bulletin Board. If you have an event you would like us to announce, send it 2 weeks in advance to cbb@wbai.org.
Thank you, Earth Mom, for those announcements from the Community Bulletin Board. Before that, we heard the Jordan Journal, hosted and produced by Howard Jordan, heard Fridays at 3 p.m. here on WBAI New York, 99.5 FM, and WBAI.org on the web. Stay tuned now for State of the Arts NYC with Savona Bailey-McClain coming up.
Good evening. This is State of the Arts NYC, where we cover art. And this is your host, Savona Bailey-McClain. Tonight on our show, our theme is Winter is Here. And we will spotlight art fairs and new exhibitions. Joining us in the studio will be Stephen Powers. And Stephen Powers is an art dealer. And we'll be participating in the Outsider Art Show that's going to start next weekend. We also will have joining us on the show Michael Diaz-Griffith, who is the Associate Executive Director of the Winter Antiques Show, another art fair that will be starting next week. Over the last 3 years, Mr. Griffith has helped evolve the visual identity of the show and expand its digital footprint. We also will be having with us two art dealers that will be participating in the New York Ceramics and Glass Fair. That's Leslie Ferrin, owner of Ferrin Contemporary Gallery, and Robert Walker, the owner of the Polka Dot Antiques Gallery. And we are very excited about that because we have been a big-time supporter of the New York Ceramics and Glass Fair, which is held at a beautiful, beautiful location, the Bohemian National Hall on 73rd Street on the Upper East Side. So let's get started. We have Stephen in the studio who's going to talk to us about his, his gallery, his practice, and what motivates him to talk about outsider art. So welcome, Michael. Thank you so much.
Hi, Savona. Thanks for having me.
You're welcome.
Come a little close.
All right.
So, Stephen, tell us, what motivated you to collect Native American art and also works that deal with spirituality?
Well, it was an immediate attraction. I come from a fine arts background, and one of the first things that I saw when I started collecting antiques was a burl bowl.
Oh,
and
really?
A burl bowl that was carved by a Woodlands Indian artist, and it just captivated me. And I took out a credit card, paid for it. I couldn't afford it, but I had to have it.
Okay.
And so for a while, I was a collector, and I wanted to know more about this material, but there was not enough information out there. It was scattered in books, but it really wasn't codified.
Mm-hmm.
So as I was collecting, I started to organize my research, and I eventually wrote a book on the material, which is North American Burletrine, Colonial and Native American, which deals in woodlands Indian art.
All right. So for the benefit of our audience, because we have not had the opportunity, and I'm glad, we've only had one other person on our show, one of the curators who works at the Smithsonian Institute at the Native American Museum in Lower Manhattan to talk about Native American art. But her show was focusing on light technology and its use with Native American art. But you're talking about something very specific, woodland,
yeah,
Native American art. So tell us a little bit, what does that mean?
Well, the woodlands Indian art generally covers the Great Lakes over to the eastern seaboard, down to Virginia. It's kind of not really a well-defined area,
mm-hmm,
but it's just mainly East Coast art. It's mainly occupied by the Iroquois.
Okay.
And they their aesthetic was very understated.
Mm-hmm.
They had an amazing line quality and a quiet sophistication. They were intimate objects.
Okay.
Bowls and ladles. Which were spoons. They were eating utensils.
Mm-hmm.
These weren't just something that they would shove in a drawer.
Mm-hmm.
These were personal totems.
Ah.
These were important ceremonial or just daily ritual objects for them,
mm-hmm,
food preparation.
Mm-hmm.
And what we were talking about, or what I wrote about with the material, is burl. It's which is the knotty outgrowth on a tree.
Mm-hmm.
It's that pregnant bump that, mm-hmm, you find on a tree. That, mm-hmm, is the burl.
Okay.
And most of it is ash burl that in the historic sense.
Wow, that was pretty fascinating. I did not know that much about the woodland sort of aspect of Native American art. And I liked how you described it, that you said that they were able to use these daily objects as like personal totems. So they really reverent all of their daily life and the uses with those items. And that's really kind of cool, because nowadays people think it's all about flash and...
No, these were
something had to be very expensive.
Yeah, no, these were very quiet but meaningful,
mm-hmm,
very sophisticated objects, though.
Mm-hmm.
They were what we call them, effigy ladles.
Mm.
They often would have a little totem at the end, like a bird or an owl or, mm-hmm, a panther or a beaver,
mm-hmm, okay,
something that was meaningful to the owner.
Okay, that's great. Now, that's one area that you specialize in, but you also specialize with works that deal with spirituality. How did that begin for you as well?
Well, it actually comes out from the woodlands Indian art and,
okay,
and their concept of,
mm-hmm,
of spirit within the material.
Okay. So the people who've made those works, are they Native American, or are they folk artists, or are they from other parts of the world?
Well, a lot of them are Native American, but especially with folk art, you do cross over to a certain reverence, whether it's personally meaningful or whether it has to do with Christianity,
mm-hmm,
or other religions.
Okay.
Whether it's something that's meaningful for the maker,
mm-hmm,
because when they made these things, they didn't think that they were going to be shown or seen or even collected. They were making them for themselves.
Okay, that's interesting, because I listened to you when you talked about the area where you were collecting the woodland, which, mm-hmm, is across, I would say, the northern part of the country. Then you go to the East Coast and you're going a little further south. And,
yep,
when you think about those regions and some of the people that live there, you can understand and appreciate that they take religion very seriously.
Sure.
And a lot of it was works that they did themselves. They wasn't trying to become what we have defined as artists today.
Right.
They just were doing it for the pleasure of doing it,
sure,
and for
a certain compulsion.
Yes,
to make it.
Yeah. So that's very interesting how the two combine together. Sort of a shamanistic sort of element, correct?
Yeah, yes.
Okay, good. So now tell me, how did you get involved with the Outsider Art Fair?
Well, I come from a fine arts background, and I said that before, but sorry.
That's all right. You can repeat.
In case you forgot. Outsider art I found very challenging.
Okay.
Folk art I understood easier,
mm-hmm.
and there's often a confusion, and it's not well defined even within the field of what is folk art, what is outsider. And I think part of the problem is that outsider art is defined by the condition of the artist, not the art itself. So it's usually reverse. Usually you have a certain genre and it's judged or categorized that way. Outsider art, it goes the opposite way, where it defines the people who make the art. And so I think that's why it's sometimes difficult to define what is outsider art.
Mm-hmm.
If you go to Facebook or any social media and talk about art, it's outsider art, everyone has a different opinion,
mm-hmm.
What defines it. And
mm-hmm.
And there's no clear-cut definition.
Okay.
So I started to explore for this fair.
Mm-hmm.
I'm exhibiting a collection of works that I would call insider outsider.
Okay.
And I'm looking to see, can you come from, could you have had instruction, art instruction?
Mm-hmm.
'Cause usually the definition of an outsider art is self-taught.
Right.
And then may have had other influences or may have been on the fringe of society. But could you have received some instruction? And then situations, whether it's economic, sexuality, ethnicity, or even mental health, that may make you an outsider.
Mm-hmm.
And there's certain artists that I've brought to the fair or bring to the fair. Frank Colbert, who was a Chickasaw Indian,
mm-hmm.
He in the 1920s came to New York and really was an outsider. There was not a history, a lineage of Native Americans participating in quote unquote fine art, and then there's Forrest Bess, who is an artist, a well known artist in Texas,
mm-hmm.
Who for a short period of time was making some exploratory works in the late 1940s, but then instantly got kind of thrown into the New York art scene by being exhibited working with the gallery Betty Parsons.
Okay.
Who Forrest Bess was all of a sudden being shown with Jackson Pollock and Mark Rothko.
Whoa.
And so what happens to an outsider artist when they're thrust into the New York art scene?
Right.
What happens to their art afterwards?
Right.
Does it remain kind of pure?
Or do they evolve like Thornton Dial?
Yes, exactly. Which I think Thornton Dial is a good example. Forrest Bess is another good example.
Yes.
Where it gives them confidence to explore things.
Yes.
That maybe they weren't going to explore. It might go the other way,
mm-hmm.
where they kind of think, okay, this is what people want, and start making the same thing over and over again. And that happens in music.
Okay.
Where, when an artist comes onto the scene, they're popular, everyone likes what they're doing, then all of a sudden no one likes their third album because it hasn't explored new area.
Yes. That's very good. I think what you're trying to do, you're posing some very good questions and allowing people to examine art in a very different way. So
yeah.
That's fantastic. So tell us, before we end our segment, who are some of the artists you're going to be showing?
There's Forrest Best.
Okay.
There's Dilmus Hall.
Mm-hmm.
Ida Ella Jones.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's John Roeder is mm-hmm. another one, a California artist. And Frank Colbert. That painting that I'll be bringing there is really an amazing discovery.
Mm-hmm.
It just has to be seen to believe, but it's a painting called The Trail to the Happy Hunting Ground, which
okay.
is it's about going to the afterworld. It is a spiritual piece.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Well, that's good. Well, thank you so much, because I, like I said, I'm a big supporter of the Outsider Art Fair. We had Saya Wolfick on last week, where she's going to do a special curated space that's going to be in response to St. Om.
Yep.
And we've had her on the show before, and it was delightful to talk with her again about what she's doing. And I'm encouraging people to go to the Outsider Art Fair, because they've shown some fantastic people. Yeah. Thornton.
It's never boring.
Trailer. Yeah. Other interesting people, quilts that people might remember, love to see, and you just never know. You find those wonderful, beautiful gems right there at the market.
Yeah. It's not intimidating. It's very accessible, and it's never boring.
Yes. Yeah. Well, thank you so much for joining us, and I look forward to seeing you at the fair.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. And we are back with State of the Arts NYC, where we cover art. And we just had a wonderful, wonderful conversation with Steve Powers. Now, Steve Powers is considered one of the country's leading specialists in Native American and woodlands sculpture. And he's also a leading dealer in the American folk art. I also wanted to say that he is the president of the Antique Dealers Association as well. So I'm so glad that we were able to have Steve onto the show. Now, we will have Leslie Ferrin, owner of Ferrin Contemporary Gallery, and Robert Walker, owner of the Polka Dot Antiques Gallery. Are you there, Leslie and Robert?
I am.
Yes, I'm here.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you both for joining us. I was so happy that you were able to come onto our show, because I happen to love the New York Ceramics and Glass Fair. It's, you know, a real beautiful show at the Bohemian National Hall, and I'm encouraging more and more people every single year to go out there, check it out, see what's there, because the works are really quite fantastic. So, Les, let me just kick off with you. Tell us a little bit about your gallery and what you hope to bring to the fair.
Well, thank you so much for asking. We have artworks by contemporary artists who work as their primary material in ceramics. Mm-hmm. And most of the work we're showing this year has a reference to history. So the artists were invited to look at a historic collection from Henry Clay Frick.
And
they looked at paintings, and they looked at ceramics, and they looked at tile, and they looked at history of the Frick family.
Mm-hmm.
So we're getting the opportunity to see works that were made for the show in a special exhibition, and there'll be a lecture on the process of the artist and working with the curator, working with the collection. And her name is Dawn Green, and the collection is the Frick Historic Mansion in Pittsburgh.
So, yeah, I went to the University of Pittsburgh.
So you probably know the wonderful house there.
Yes.
And the museum. So we got together with them and these 20 artists, and some of them are from Australia, and some are from England, and some are working in Jingdezhen in China. But it's a wonderful way to sort of survey what's going on internationally with these masters who are interpreting masterworks of the past.
That's very clever. Yes, I remember the Henry Frick house that was at I would say at the northern portion of the campus, because in Pittsburgh, as you know, the colleges are kind of like they follow each other like a line. You know, you have Duquesne,
yep,
and then you have Pitt, and you have Chatham, and you have Carnegie Mellon. And so they all kind of continue up this sort of trail. And yes, I remember that building very well. So that's
interesting. It's pretty exciting, because we're also able to bring in the work of three very young artists who this is the first time they've worked this way. And so they will be discussing the process of, recreating a work, inspired by history,
mm-hmm,
and putting their own contemporary, social issues like environmentalism or, sort of social practice. So those artists will be on the panel talking to the curator. So for me, it's a win-win situation where I get my audience, I get the curators, and I get the artists all interacting with each other. And that's one of the joys of the fair, is being able to go in and look at the work, handle it, talk about the history of these objects, and meet the people involved.
All right. And now, Robert, now,
yes.
Polka Dot Antiques. I love the name Polka Dot Antiques. I love polka dots. But now you deal with a lot of British pottery, correct?
That's what I specialize in at the moment. That's where I feel I know the most about the history of ceramics, and I can concentrate on just that.
Mm-hmm. Now, who will you be presenting at the New York Ceramics and Glass Fair? Any artists that we should be looking out for?
It's basically, it's more like wares, types of ware. It's Delft ware, it's agate ware, it's cream wares. And then I go from the 17th century, 1670s Delft wares, right through to the, actually, 1920s.
Okay. That's quite a range.
Yeah, it's quite a range. But I have, like, two sections. I have, like, 17th and 18th century, early 19th, and I stop and I jump to the late 19th century, about 1880 through to 1920, which is British art pottery.
Mm-hmm.
The type of ware that was produced, arts and crafts, British art pottery.
All right. And how long have you been doing this?
Well, I've only been running Polka Dot Antiques for 3 years, but my involvement in ceramics stems from my degree in ceramic history, the BA, back in 1979.
Okay, so you've been doing this for quite some time.
Oh, yes. In fact, in sympathy with the... Leslie, I used to teach ceramic potters, the history of ceramics and studio pottery at Loughborough University.
Okay.
Under the auspices of John Scott.
Okay.
So we have some link there in the past.
All right. Now, what makes the New York Ceramics and Glass Fair special for you, Robert?
It's the fact that museum curators, collectors, and dealers from all over America, and in fact from Europe, Britain, France, Germany, come together for a highly specialist fair that's not done anywhere else in the world.
Mm-hmm.
There used to be one in London several years ago, but now there isn't. This is the only specialist ceramics and glass fair that I know that exists.
Wow. Okay. So when people come to this, they're really seeing the best from this genre then.
Well, you're seeing the best and most interested people, the curators from all the museums and the gallery owners, and they're seeing, hopefully, the very best from specialist dealers that specialize purely in a very narrow tunnel vision sort of sense of Chinese export or studio pottery or, like I said, British art pottery or French or, and there's glass collectors, glass dealers as well. You just do 18th century glass. They're highly specialist glass people.
Okay. So now I have a question for both of you, because one of the things that I try to explain to listeners and colleagues or friends is that, collecting isn't, just, for the wealthy. It's really for everybody. And you can start off, with small pieces, and you can grow with an artist, or you can grow in a particular discipline, or you can switch things up. But what would you say to folks when it comes to this fair? Are there things that they can, start off with and then grow over time?
Leslie?
Well, I'll pop that one in. With these young artists, a lot of their work is being shown for, they're sort of within the first few years of being out of their graduate school program. So, in fact, I said to them, how are you going to afford your plane ticket with these prices? but they are so excited about being here and being included and being able to talk with all these experts that, and their work is, it's the first time that they're really showing in this genre. So our price range will be, from the hundreds up into the multiple thousands. But, so for the audience, you can, jump in there along with the young artists and be a young collector and find things and grow with that generation.
Right.
Some things are just really affordable. I'm surprised because, but you can say if you want to move up the ladder, either as a collector or as a, an artist, you can find something at every price range. And you know, start your collection or build on it or discover somebody new or buy a masterpiece. It's, right. you know, something for every, you know, stage, don't you think?
Yes. Weigh in,
Robert. It's the same with ceramics in terms of antique ceramics. More and more dealers and collectors today are buying to decorate. Mm. So the tastes have changed a lot in the last 20 years. As far as museums are concerned, an object needs to tell a story now.
Yes, that's very true.
It has to have a whole social history sort of documentation influence all about it. And in terms of decorating with pottery, people might buy 15 or 20 objects that all of the same color or similar color or type of ware to put behind their desk in their library. It's a decorative market. It's a decorative influence now compared to the academic influence that was 15, 20 years ago.
Okay. Do you think that's a good thing, a good trend?
I think so, certainly. I mean, times change. You know, like I said, museum curators 20 or 30 years ago were interested in something because it was academically important,
mm-hmm.
Whereas the public may have been turned off by it. Today,
okay.
the public want to go to a museum to see something interesting and stunning that tells a story about social history or its place in the 1790s or the 1820s and how it fits in with that era.
Okay. All right. So we're actually cultivating a more interesting viewership now. They really are interested, and they're making some demands. I think that's a positive thing.
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm saying, exactly. Mm-hmm. I mean, the museum's responding to public demand.
Okay, this is good. Well, now, the Ceramics and Glass Fair begins next week, correct, on the 18th?
That's correct.
Yep. Okay. And there's a whole set of lectures that bring curators and artists together on Friday. So they start at 12 o'clock with an artist whose work was featured in the New York Times today,
okay.
Peter Pinkus, who's barely over 30 years old.
Okay.
And I can't wait to show him an 8-inch vase picture of a vase that's 19 inches. So it's like wow. almost half the size of the vase in the New York Times.
He's okay.
thrilled.
All right. Well, I just want to thank the both of you for coming on to the show. I also like to thank Marilyn White, who's been very helpful in making sure that I can get dealers to talk about this fair. It's a beautiful fair. It's a lovely fair in the Bohemian National Hall, which is on 73rd Street on the Upper East Side. And I tell folks, don't let the weather hold you back, because we've had some snow sometimes, but I think it is worth the trek. It's a lovely building where you can relax, have lunch or tea or coffee, and just really get to meet some great dealers, see some fabulous works on multiple floors, and enjoy the rest of the day. So thank you for coming onto the show and sharing with us. I look forward to meeting the both of you next week.
Sounds good.
Same here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
All right. Back with State of the Arts NYC, where we cover art. And we just had on our show Leslie Ferrin and Robert Walker. Leslie Ferrin is the owner of the Ferrin Contemporary Gallery, and Robert Walker is the owner of the Polka Dot Fine Arts Gallery, really antiques, British pottery. So we had a lovely conversation with the two of them. A reminder to our listeners, January is a big month. It's not, you know, a very quiet month. We kick the year off. So we will have New York Ceramics and Glass Fair, and we will have Outsider Art Fair. That would be next week. Also kicking off next week is Americana Week. So that includes Sotheby's, that includes Christie's, and the Winter Antique Show. And I'm very happy that we have joining us Michael Diaz-Griffith, who is the Associate Executive Director of the Winter Antique Show. Welcome, Michael. How are you?
Good evening. I'm doing well, thank you. Very pleased to be speaking with you tonight.
Yes, thank you so much for joining us. And I know you're busy. You're getting ready for the fair next week, to say the least, which will be at the Park Avenue Armory on Park Avenue. But I just wanted you to share with us what folks could expect if they were to attend the Winter Antique Show. So why don't you tell us some highlights?
All right. Well, for those who haven't been, the Winter Antique Show is a sale of fine and decorative art that takes place, as you said, at the Park Avenue Armory, mm-hmm. in a space that many are familiar with, but is still awe-inspiring to me, that takes up basically a city block.
Yes.
So, you know, from Park Avenue to Lexington, practically, and 67th Street to 66th Street are displays of masterworks from around the world being presented by 70 of the world's top experts in their disciplines. And there are many special events. There is a fabulous opening night party on January 18th, mm-hmm. An event called Young Sculptors Night that we can speak about. But the main attraction of the show is this diverse, rich, eclectic, amazing array of art and design that everyone can not only look at, but because we're not a museum, they can mm-hmm. touch it, handle it, ask questions about the works, and enjoy conversations with the experts who come each year to the Winter Antique Show to present their material.
And that's one of the things I like about the show, because, you know, sometimes people think that when you talk about antiques, it's something, you know, stuffy and foreboding, and there's, you know, a lot of distance with it. But it's not. You guys are very welcoming and friendly, and the stories, as we heard from two other dealers, are really interesting for a lot of the works. Last year you had a lot of a special showcase, and that dealt with Virginia, and I think it was Colonial Williamsburg, and you showcased a lot of that, and it was really quite interesting because, you know, the stories behind it were about these various makers and how they were living life, and so I thought it was kind of cool. It wasn't foreboding. It wasn't stuffy. It was kind of hip a little bit.
Absolutely. No, and I think, and I should mention that we have a fabulous loan exhibition mm-hmm. for 2018 from the Virginia Museum of Fine Arts
okay.
in Richmond.
Okay.
So we're continuing with the Virginia theme, mm-hmm. And the loan exhibition is called Collecting for the Commonwealth, Preserving okay. for the Nation, Celebrating a Century of Art Patronage, and in the loan exhibition this year is actually really based on and pivots on narratives, because okay. the selection of works is incredibly diverse. From, you know, there's a Fabergé egg, there's a Van Gogh painting, there is, you know, there are antiquities, there's a fabulous array of works.
Mm-hmm.
What unites them, or what, you know, the thematic link between them is that they were given by patrons of the museum to what is the country's first state-owned museum.
Ah.
So it's a story about patronage and the people behind the object
mm-hmm.
that will sort of shine through in the display. And, you know, like you said, when you're speaking to the exhibitors, they want to talk.
Yeah.
They want to tell you stories mm-hmm. about the object, about the adventures they've had in pursuit of them.
Yes, and those
and
are quite
their
fascinating.
Careers. So it's, you know, it's really something else.
Yes, yes. I have heard from dealers, you know, a lot of people don't realize museums go to dealers. Because you
have the show.
Well, you have access. See, that's what, but a lot of people don't realize that. Because dealers, you know, trying to, you know, take a little page out of Indiana Jones, that's what you guys deal with sometimes. You're going off on excursions, and you're able to go into, you know, crevices and remote places, and you get to talk to people, and you get to, you know, kind of, you know, cajole them to allow you to have this object that maybe some of them are scared to give, and so that you can present it, talk about it, and maybe, you know, give to another person who would love it as much. And so you're able to do things that sometimes bigger museums are not able to do and showcase it. So there's a lot of thrills behind all of this, presentation that you're giving to the public. So I just want to let people know it's kind of fun. It's not just, you know, academics. It's also real fun.
Yeah. It is fun. And I think that, you know, you mentioned museums, they do shop the show.
Mm-hmm.
And so visitors to the show should feel confidence
mm-hmm.
in the authenticity and quality of the material, because, first of all, it's vetted. And
okay.
I don't know if we've ever discussed that on your show, but it's one of the, you know, the elements of a show like ours
mm-hmm.
really sets us apart.
Mm-hmm.
And this means that a committee of 150 experts from the United States and Europe examine each and every object in the show prior to its opening for those elements I just mentioned,
mm-hmm.
you know, authenticity, date, and condition. And that means that the museums feel comfortable shopping
right.
the show.
Right.
But more importantly, for our purposes here, it means that the public should feel comfortable shopping the show.
Okay.
Because not only have experts presented the material, you know, our dealers, but other experts, third parties, have come to the show to verify the claims made by our exhibitors and to put their, you know, stamp of
their seal of approval.
Authority.
Yeah,
exactly. Their seal of approval on the works. That's one point. And then, you know, secondly, there are masterpieces and masterworks at the show that may be priced in the millions. We still don't know what all will be at the show. We have an idea from our exhibitors of what they're bringing, but we don't have, you know, extensive survey of all of the thousands of objects that will be arriving at the armory on Monday, Tuesday in preparation for the show.
All right.
But we do know that there will be, you know, fabulous masterworks, but also there will be smalls and, you know, silver spoons and boxes and smaller items that are buyable. You know,
mm-hmm,
and that
mm-hmm.
and that constitutes a great deal of the fun of the show. You can come and you carry it out under your arm, go home and say, I bought it at the Winter Antique Show.
Yes.
Like the museum.
Yes.
So there's a real diversity that means that it can be an adventure for anyone to
yes.
attend.
Yes, and I like that. You said an adventure. And so therefore, if you bought something that was small and delicate, that could be an heirloom for your children or grandchildren or nieces and nephews. You know, you want to make it personal because you enjoyed that story. You want to bring that story forward into the 21st century and you know, engage with others. So I think this is fantastic. Now tell us again, when does the Winter Antique Show begin?
Our opening night party is on January 18th,
mm-hmm.
and I encourage your listeners to attend
mm-hmm.
and to celebrate the opening of the show with us
mm-hmm.
At what is our preview party next Thursday night from 5 to 9.
Okay.
And the show opens the following day
on
Friday, January 19th, and runs through Sunday, January 28th.
Great. So that's a nice long run for people to go.
It's a long one.
And it's a long run. And I tell people, don't let the weather hinder you. Right now, we're doing very well with weather. Let's, you know, stay focused and enjoy all of these various fairs that are taking place, as well as festivals that really showcase America's best. Let's put it that
way.
Absolutely. All right. Well, go ahead.
And I would encourage folks to check out our website,
that's what I was about to say.
Events page, because
mm-hmm.
one of the really, really fun elements of the loan exhibition is that curators from the lending institution come up to New York to obviously interpret the exhibition for the crowds at the Armory, and they also give lectures. Those lectures are complimentary with admission.
Mm-hmm.
You can really make a day of it.
Mm-hmm.
Come and see the show, visit the loan exhibition, attend a loan exhibition lecture, or indeed another lecture.
Mm-hmm.
There are several others besides the ones associated with the loan exhibition, and even eat at the show in our cafe.
Yes.
But, you know, it's amazing because you won't hear these experts from Virginia speaking on topics related to their collection just anywhere. They
mm-hmm.
sort of come here to spread the word, to share their knowledge and their stories, and that's the only week when you can hear it in New York.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Michael, for joining us. We look forward to coming next week, and I wish you all the best with the Winter Antique Show.
Thank you so much, and I hope that you will join us yourself,
mm-hmm.
and we certainly look forward to seeing you at the Park Avenue Armory.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Have a good evening.
You
Bye.
Too.
Jan Arts NYC is one of the largest and most influential gatherings of performing arts in the world, a partnership among 11 independent and multidisciplinary festivals. 45,000 arts leaders, entertainers, and enthusiasts converge in New York for network learning, professional development, mentorship, cultural exchange, awards, and peer acknowledgement. The Office of Media and Entertainment is proud to be a supporting partner. Participating artists, Chamber Music America, the Public Theaters Under the Radar Festival, Prototype Opera Theater Now, International Society for the Performing Arts, Joyce Theater's American Dance Platform, American Realness, PS122's Coil Festival, NYC Winter Jazz Fest, Wavelengths, APAP Music World Pre-Conference, APAP NYC 2018, and Global Fest. The public can enjoy innovative works hosted around New York City. For more information, go to janartsnyc.org.
And we are back with State of the Arts NYC, where we cover art. We just had Michael Diaz-Griffith, who is the Associate Executive Director of the Winter Antique Show. They will also open up next week, starting on the 18th. This is very exciting for New York. Now we have with us, I'm so glad she was able to come back this week for us, Claren McFadden. Claren McFadden is a soprano, and she is participating and doing her U.S. premiere for the Prototype Festival and her production of Secrets. And she does this production with a band, and they source hundreds of anonymous testimonies from the general public and audience members to craft a personal and intense experience. Thank you so much, Claren, for joining us. How are you?
My pleasure. Thank you.
You're welcome. So tell us, how did you come up with this idea for doing this operatic performance with a band called Secrets?
Well, I actually got the book by Frank Warren called Post Secrets as a birthday present a few years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought it was so amazing that people gave him or entrusted him with their most inner secrets and stories and wishes, and they were quite universal. And I thought I would be very interested to explore this. And I had this project with this trio, an amazing trio, and we were looking for a subject. And I thought, what if we, the musicians, were the postcard, as it were? The book was called Post Secrets, and I gave a voice to the secrets, because it seems that we always need to confess them. You know, nobody takes a secret to their grave.
Right.
So that's how it started.
Wow, that's pretty intense, because you're right. People like to confess their secrets on their deathbed. They just have to share, you know, things that they feel they need to say before they leave this earth. And so that's quite provocative in and of itself. What types of secrets have people shared with you?
Well, I particularly was interested in senior citizens because, unfortunately, in our society, they don't really count. So I went to various senior centers in Brussels and in a few other places, and left secret boxes sort of in the lobbies, and explained to the people what I was doing and that they could trust me. And they gave me so many stories, lots of memories, lots of stories of women in that age who were like in their 80s now, who were found ways of empowering themselves in a kind of quite strict, harnessed society. And then we also went to online. We just put a general thing out, and people responded. But actually what's interesting is every city in which we play, in every country, we actually ask the people to give us secrets. So we have many, many secrets from New Yorkers that are in this particular show. So it's actually a handmade, tailor-made show for New York. We've done it in Sydney and Lyon and different places.
Wow. Now, you're going to be premiering tomorrow night, correct?
Yes. That's right.
That must be exciting for you at National Sawdust, too.
Yes, absolutely. It's a beautiful space, and we have some projections that we're going to have. And, it's really exciting. It's really exciting.
Yes, we had National Sawdust on our show just a few months ago. And because they do a lot of, you know, really cool residencies and programs and sponsor a lot of different artists. And we were showcasing one particular program that they have. But I think this is very exciting that you're doing this at National Sawdust.
So I am extremely excited.
I can hear it in your voice. You're really, really happy about it. So go ahead. I'm sorry for interrupting. You wanted to say one other thing?
No, I just said I'm very excited, and the musicians they're fantastic. It's sort of this kind of an almost filmic, improvised, something in between classical, jazz. It's very profound, very special music. The musicians wrote the music as well. And I said that the secrets themselves indicated which musical context they wanted in order to be voiced. So that was the thing I wanted to say.
Well, you
kind of... The secrets themselves actually tell us what they want.
You kind of answered my other question, because that's what I was going to say. How do you determine what the music will be, and how do you convey the secrets? Do you tell the secrets exactly as it was written to you, or do you modify any of the secrets, or do you combine secrets together?
We sort of, because many of the secrets, initial secrets we got were in French. So I translated them into English. Some of them, we sort of concised them because there were a lot of explanations of things. But pretty much the idea was to do the secrets as they were given to me. And so they're in their pure form. And it's beautiful. Some people wrote handwritten ones, and you could actually see in the way they wrote them what they actually wanted. So that was really great. Very exciting.
That's really, that must be one interesting process, to say the least, because you're reading all of these personal, you know, notations, and it kind of conjures, you know, these visions in your mind. And then is that what you do to project in this operatic performance?
Yes, I mean, I call it a kind of theatrical concert, where the idea was as if it was our last night. The whole audience were together. It's, you know, it's our last night. Could be the last night on earth. It could be who knows what. But and it's a night of sharing and expressing these things. So we have a very intimate setting in which the whole audience feels that they're a part of this. This ritual of confession. And for me, that the task, it's a bit like the quote unquote storyteller, the leader of the thing. And, it's finding the way to actually give life to the secrets without actually contaminating them with my own, opinion or my own judgment. And so that was the actual challenge, that people have space to fill in their own interpretation of what that secret means. And many, many people have said after performances, that could have been my secret. Or they actually, I see that people even feel the need to write secrets. So we put boxes.
Wow.
After each performance. We might do it here in New York as well. And,
wow.
And so we keep, there's a sort of rotation of secrets. We have, I think I may have 200, 250 secrets that, that I've collected over the years.
Oh my God. That's interesting that people are so compelled that afterwards they would still share their secrets.
Yeah, they need to somehow. There seems to be some kind of compulsion that there is this need to clean. I don't know what it is. Clean the heart or the soul or the mind. And you see people agitated, and they're like, I have a secret, and they're struggling. Shall I tell it? I need to tell it. I've had it for such a long time. And in the end, well, we put the box there, and some people are rushing to put their secret in. Some are, they want to, but they don't dare. Mm. Little children. I mean, it's really quite a profound experience of sharing. It feels indeed like a ritual, a cleansing ritual in a way. And I'm part of that. We are part of that ritual.
So,
and that's really powerful.
So tell us about your training. You're a soprano opera singer. And how did you begin your musical journey?
Well, I started actually basically in the Eastman Children's Chorus. I'm from upstate New York, from Rochester.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, I went to Eastman School of Music and studied voice. So I have a degree in singing, a bachelor's. And there I was already very interested in old music, in Renaissance polyphonic music, in music theater. I was doing everything except the traditional sort of opera things there,
mm-hmm.
working with the jazz musicians, with contemporary music. And so I got a scholarship to go to Europe for a year. And I ended up in the Netherlands, and it was exactly the right place. So I've been there ever since. It's been about 35 years. And I basically did a mixture of contemporary music and French Baroque music quite a bit, and Handel, and then sort of jazz musicians started asking me to do improvisational projects, and I've been doing music theater projects and opera projects. So it's been quite a broad journey that I have, but I am indeed a classically trained singer.
Wow. Well, I just want to thank you so much for joining us and speaking with us tonight, and I want to wish you the very, very best on your U.S. premiere tomorrow night of Secrets. And I hope to get to meet you and during the Prototype Festival, because it was such a pleasure talking with you.
Yeah, my pleasure. Thank you very much. And thank all the people who gave us those secrets. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We are back with State of the Arts NYC, where we cover art. So we're about to wrap up our show. We had a great lineup, and I want to thank all of our guests who was on tonight. That's Steve Powers, Leslie Ferrin, Robert Walker, Michael Diaz-Griffith, and Clarence McFadden. But before we go, I just wanted to give a shout out to some important people who deserve them, particularly this week. I want to give a shout out to Reese Taylor, who recently passed away about 2 weeks ago. I want to give a shout out to the people of Haiti. I want to give a shout out to all the people who live on the continent, not country, of Africa. I want to give a shout out to all the people that live in El Salvador. We want you to know that not everyone in the United States feel that they are so above everyone else that they cannot recognize the contributions of people around the world. And please do not fault all the people in the United States for the man who happens to occupy the White House temporarily until we can get him out. So I wish to thank everyone. Have a great week, and we will see you next week. Bye-bye.
The campaign to bring Mumia home invites you to the second premiere episode of Inside the Activist Studio, featuring Ramona Africa and Roxanne Dunbar Ortiz in conversation about white supremacy and her new book, Loading, A Disarming History of the Second Amendment. Join us Tuesday, January 9th, 6 p.m. at the Graduate Center, 365 Fifth Avenue between 35th and 34th Streets. For further information, write bringmumiahome@gmail.com or call the number 347-709-2264.
Imhotep Gary Bird inviting you to join us for Radio GBE, the Global Black Experience and the Global Beat Experience, where the message is in the music, Friday nights, 6 to 8 p.m. Join us for all the features, interviews, guest coverage, and the music mix you've come to expect, and, of course, the things that light up your Friday night here in New York City and across the country and right through the diaspora. Pass the word, Bird is flying high in the New York sky with Radio GBE, radio in the key of life. Friday nights, 6 to 8 p.m., right here on WBAI 99.5 FM and WBAI.org.
There was a song came on the radio, a guitar instrumental, and it changed everything.
Link Ray, it's rock and roll.
Rumble. Yeah, that's the one.
Rumble.
Hey, Rumble.
Rumble had the power to help me say, I'm going to be a musician.
And then I found out that he was an Indian.
The music that we know here in the United States is fully supported by input from Native and Indigenous people.
Say hello, this is John Cain from WBAI's Let's Talk. Join me on January 31st at 7 p.m. at the Brooklyn Commons, 388 Atlantic Avenue in Brooklyn, as we kick off 2018 with a free screening of Rumble, the Indians who rocked the world.
Hi, this is DJ Baby K from The Sweet Spot. On the go, but want to support the station dedicated to you, the listener? No problem. Simply dial 41444 and text TRANSMIT 995 to make a pledge by text. Support WBAI's unique voice and keep us on the air during this critical time. Once again, dial 41444 and text TRANSMIT 995 to make your pledge. Thanks for supporting listener-sponsored community radio, WBAI 99.5 FM.
The current administration in Washington has done so many horrible things to the air, water, wildlife, land use, energy use, and environmental justice that it will take two episodes of Ecologic to cover it. Tune in on Tuesday, January 2nd and 16th at 8 p.m. to hear environmental experts and activists discuss what the administration has done and what we can do about it. Right here on WBAI New York, 99.5 FM and WBAI.org.
Now during the fun drive, you don't have to keep calling back because of busy signals or have to pull over to the side of the road or miss the show you were listening to in order to make your pledge.
Blah, 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 blah.
Now you can donate and choose your thank you gift online at your convenience at any time. Go to the new WBAI online donation site at www.givetowbai.org. That's give, the number two, WBAI.org. You can also pledge in the name of your favorite show, choosing it from the drop-down menu, and whether you would like to be thanked on the air. Just go to www.givetowbai.org.
Hi, I'm Wuyi Jacobs, producer and host of Afrobeat Radio, a public affairs program presenting African perspectives on global issues. Join us every Saturday from 6 to 7 p.m. right here on WBAI New York 99.5 FM and WBAI.org.